Thank you, Mubarak. So, it is good to see you in the middle of the summer, all of you. This talk is about object recognition. And I'm in it for 10 years, or at least, well, the paper Mubarak referred to was written at the end of 2000. It was called object recognition or content-based image retrieval at the end of the early years. And then after that, actually, it was the right title in hindsight, because in 2002 we participated in the first TrackFit competition of the topic, and we were very pleased that the result was different from a random result. We could demonstrate by statistical testing, but you couldn't see it. But if you typed in horse, then here and there were slightly more horses than expected from random. So that was the state of the art by the end of 2002, and I will talk about the state of the art now. We won't go over the history, but it has been a tremendous progress in 10 years. And let me summarize my experience with the topic. So we first go over bag of words, and then I'll discuss a few items out of that. Before there were words, if this is an image and you want to summarize it, you would look for salient points of different scales, as indicated by the radius of the yellow circles, and in these areas there's something the matter, so to say. So if you want to summarize it, you could search for maybe, say, 1,000 different words or different patches, and you would measure a lot of features of that because you don't know at what image you're looking. So you wouldn't, before that time, you would typically design features specifically for each individual object, but at this point you would measure many different feature dimensions, at least say 128 or even more, and you would do it at many places in the image. If you would store it, you get huge store spaces, so this wasn't working for large amounts of features. And one image would typically generate 100k feature values. So then there came the big improvement, which is summarized in this stream. That typically you would measure a patch, and then you would sample many patches, and you would do that for many images with a known label. And this is the only a priori knowledge which goes into it. So you know that the image has a label, you don't know anything or much more of the image. Later we will see variations of it. And then you construct a dictionary which tells you how to map these patches into which of them have enough information in it that they are important, and you would count their presences. And then by counting the presences, you would form histograms. And then for an unknown image, you would do the same. You would go over and look at patches in the image. You would sample them for the entire image. You would count the words again, which have now been formed here. And then you would compare this histogram with the known histograms, and you would classify the image. To each of these words in this slide, there has been much research. So, for instance, how do I characterize the pattern? Or how do I get known labels? Or how do I create a dictionary? To each of this word, there are at least 50 papers in research trying to improve this essential chain of events. So before we start to do that ourselves, let's understand this chain as good as we can. So we divide, say, an image up in patches. In this case, it's not steered by the data, but just a priori given. This is one patch, this is another patch, no interaction between the data and the choice of the pattern. And you would measure it in the sense by the same feature for every patch, not again driven by the data. And then you would map it into a feature space, which in this case is highly dimensional. It's needed to be highly dimensional, and it will occupy one dot, of course. Each patch will occupy one dot. Many dimensions are needed to capture the image complexity, because I don't know yet which image I'm looking at, so I want to see and I want to be sure that I capture any variation locally. And it appears that the classification results you're going to get, more features are better. If you have another feature set not yet covered, put it in. If you have yet another feature set measuring color, put it in. It will always lead to an increase of your performance if you have enough data. Normalized features, they rule out intensity variations in images. So if you reduce the feature complexity a little bit by normalizing your feature, you can handle any type of intensity variation. SIFT feature is the champion, and the color SIFT is better, but for broad grain categories. Broad grain means that the variation of the categories you're going to study, of the types of images, is widely apart, like an ice bear and a fire truck and a kitchen, and that is broad grain. If you have fine grain, that is the yellow wobbler from the Canadian wobbler, and I don't know how they look like actually, but it's my favorite example, that's fine grain, then SIFT is no longer the champion, because SIFT is too rude. You need to have other features. For instance, it would be very wise to put in plain yellow into that feature set. These are approximations of SIFT, and basically they work as well. Why do they work? Simply because to go up and down, so to make a differential statement, is good enough, and SURF and HOG both do that. They measure gradients as well, but they do it much faster than SIFT. As long as you capture the local complexity of the image, that's good enough. DAISY, you don't hear so much about it because it takes too long to compute, is more elegant feature. For fine grain categories, typically for the wobblers, you would typically include colors. Otherwise, you would have other features, something about the specific stochastic variation in the image. They are superior there. Okay, next is, we're not going to do it for only one patch, we're going to do it for all the patches in the image, or a selection thereof, depending on whether you want to steer it by the data. So this one has been mapped to there, this is the feature space, this one will map to another location. Let's see that one. Oh, sorry, wrong computer. There are two ways. Either you do it densely, that is for all the patches in the image, and then you need this features, this amount of samples, or you have salient data-driven sampling. Initially, people were restricted to salient sampling because they thought that would be more data efficient. And the signal-to-noise ratio, you would let the data decide which was better. But on the other hand, salient is also unstable. So dense is easier to compute, and dense is in the end most of the time better. Combined, as in the general principle, there are many papers written on the general principle of more information is better. So here is another paper that salient and dense together is also better, as long as you have enough data. Okay, so now you formed feature space for one image. You're going to repeat it on as many images as you can get your hands on. And that will be the learning set. And each label in the learning set, each image will have a label, this telling cow, and this telling, what is this, guy, and this is tree. Or maybe it has two labels, doesn't matter, but as long as it has a label correctly telling the object class you would like to assign the image to. Here comes a very important rule, you have to include all relevant distinctions between the classes, and you have to include all irrelevant variations in the patches. So if you have grass only of the golf course type, of which I'm looking out of the window these days, then you will never find grass which is yellow and dry. So you have to include that in your data set. If it's not there, it can't learn, it can't know. Now some of the things will be covered by the fact that your features are invariant, specifically chosen to be invariant. For instance, imagine if you have black and white feature sets, then the color of the grass doesn't matter, but don't blame the computer that it will find red grass because it's not there. Okay? So you have to find in your data set all relevant distinctions and all irrelevant variations which are not picked up by the feature set you are using. So not covered by the invariance of the feature. If it's covered by the invariance of the feature set, you don't have to include it in your data set. And this is much more important than the number of data. If you have, say, 1,000 very similar faces, like, say, the typical photographs they take at the border patrol, yeah, frontal view, you will get all the variations of frontal view. But as soon as when you have such face, it will not see it, because in this way the features look much different. Okay. Now you start to form the dictionary of words. You just simply, one way or another, form regions in the image, and you assume that all variation in that that part of feature space, which is a very big sphere, that within such a part there is no relevant variation. So this is one region, another region, another region. Regions can be small, regions can be huge. It depends on actually the data. Let's open up one such space. For instance, typically that if you have a region similar to this, then this is what it ideally would look like. These are all the patches gathered from all the images. Thick eyebrows, thin eyebrows, eyebrows of people with different color, and so on. This is only ideal, because later on we will see how it really looks like. And typically, people would use a dictionary of 400 words. You have to remember that this is a huge feature space. So if you form only 400 regions in that, there is large chunks of things which will need image details, which from now on will be identical, can no longer be discriminated. So 400, one way or another, is a very low number. And for houses and edifices, buildings in general, you would typically use a very large set of words which divide the same feature space in 400,000 pieces, after which, of course, every detail is now very small. So the variation within one word, covered by one word, is very small. So why is that needed? Because if every building has a window and you want to discriminate it on the details of a window, you can't swap all the windows in one word, because after it being swapped in one word, it's gone, the discrimination. You have to realize the differences. Are you with me? So if you want to have fine grain analysis of things which vary very little from its appearance, you have to have a large dictionary, otherwise it goes wrong. Okay, and in effect, words will cover several types of patches. Not this one, this is only an ideal example. And similar patches may emerge distance, we get to that later. Okay, so now we start to, these are the regions, either 400 or 400,000 or usually 4,000. And then we keep them and we fill for each image, we start to count how many of them are. So in this one, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 patches of this type, so that would be this word. And this one has 6, so that would be that one, and so on. Some of them will be very common, like blue air around birds, and the fact, and in fact, we will see in a moment that counting the words is proportional to the area in the image. I think that the log scale would do there. So it is important that there are no words of a certain type. Imagine that the word represents the part of an eye and you're searching for birds, then you would not expect it to be present. And but you would abundant presence of one word which covers equal blue. Yeah? You have only 400 words. If you have only 400 words, then you soon run out of names for those words. Yeah, it's very difficult to distinguish them. If you have 400,000, surely they don't have a name. But I think that the difference will be, is it present or not? And if it's present, then it, these different items would do. That's basically the information. So if there are more of them, that's proportional to the area it covers in the image. And the word count histogram is an important sampling of the very, very large dimensional probability density function. That's basically, from an information theoretical point of view, that's what it is. And always the result will be highly correlated, simply because, also after the counting, because not all patches of grass will be covered by the same word, and if I hit one word, then the neighbor of that pixel will cover another word. So this histogram is not ideally mutually independent dimensions, it will be highly correlated. Now, what remains to be done is that if one image in histogram space is covered by one dot and another histogram of the same type is covered by another dot, I will have to learn a plane to separate the two, and then I do it by simply comparing histograms of counting the content of the image. And at that point, it can be done either by, so this is a word count of word one, word two, word, and so on, and then I can do it by intersection, which makes it independent of occlusion. So if half of the bird I'm looking for, or half of the cow, is out of sight, doesn't matter, then still the intersection between the known unknown image and the known image is still present, or I do the scalar product, which tells you how far the histogram differs from all the other histograms examples. If I have an unknown image, I'll do the same. I chop it in patches, I measure each patch, I see where they land, I count their contents, then I have a histogram, I compare this histogram of counts with another histogram, and I classify it. In this case, I will classify it as the same, as very similar to the cow image I had before. So this is the way to assign, by the standard bag of word pipeline, an unknown image, and every day I go to work, I'm still amazed that it works. It is really amazing that you have an unknown image and can assign a useful label to it. Okay. The bag of words can best be seen as a two-stage approximation of Bayes' rule, which handles the large dimensionality of the feature space, which was necessary in order to be generically capable, and it can also handle remote correlations in the feature space. If you are novel in this field, this is the take-home message of, now we are continue details, discussing details. In effect, how do you get these are all patches, and the question is, how do I get from one patch to one word? Ideally, if these are all patches from the same origin, I would like to get this into one word. What I could do is make a raster like this, but then there is no correlation between the a priori definition of the word and the actual composition. So this definition of words would not work very well. I could do k-means. I could pick a number of means, and then I say I'm searching for k is 4,000 words, let the algorithm run, and then I would typically get this distribution, where what once was one coherent sample from the same type of image details, now all of a sudden is divided in five different words. So that's not ideal either. And this one, so most successful is radius based, but again, it's not yet, it's not exactly what you call precisely in congruence with the structure of the feature space. So for this small portion of the feature space, neither of the three standard solutions, this one is no longer in use, but neither of these two solutions is really pretty good. And that is due to the fact that you don't know a priori where how many clusters you will have and what the internal structure is. So many of the current solutions in this regard try to approximate this local arrangement in feature space in a much better way than just chopping it into words. And one of them is to do it, to make a division in words by learning it for each concept specifically. You don't know the number of k, you say it's not specific for the universal set, you learn it for each new concept anew, and then you get a serious improvement over the then existing ways how to do it. And another even more famed way of the same guy, PhD student, Jan van Gemert, published in 2010 and already cited hundreds of times, that if this is the original k-means division, he now says, well, wait a second, if I'm here, you could assign it exactly to this word, or you could also assign it in addition a bit to that and to that, and you could assign it a little bit to that. That's soft assignment, very simple to compute. You share the sigma over all words, and what you do is rather than assign it strictly to one word, if it is in the boundary, you assign it to three words. There's no more into it, and for free, you get a few percent extra scores out of 100. There are only so many improvements needed. So this was a very simple trick, that if you compare it to hard assignment, you get 2.5% extra precision. And you get much smaller code books, which are needed later on. Another improvement, this I think is the only paper not from our group, but takes a Gaussian mixed model to the local sift. So locally you fit a Gaussian and with a diagonal covariance matrix in order to be sure that you don't have to estimate too many parameters. You get a 5% improvement over the bag of words, but a much smaller dimensionality. And here you can see that if you take 256 dimensions, the occupation of these words is much more even, and ideally speaking, it would be uniform over all word sets.
So the dimension is like a sift, is the distribution 128 dimension?
Or? The dimension in this case is the dimension of the code book. So this is the dimension of 256 codes.
So in the mixed,
Gaussian model.
Mixer model, you will have what, 256 Gaussians?
Yeah, correct. To span over the complete feature space. Yep. And of course, well, so the approximate surroundings of the word in the feature space and the internal structure of the words, they are important after all. So if you have the original assignment of the word, if an arbitrary patch was exactly falling into the area of one word, it would be assigned to that word and count as an extra presence. But now, with the soft assignment, we distribute it over the local neighborhood, and with the Fisher way of thinking, we assign it to an extra hit, basically also a soft assignment. Okay, now let's look at code books. Imagine we have buildings, pictures like this of buildings, and we look where exactly that word is also positioned there. So these are two recordings of the same building, and we wonder for each specific word, where will it be in feature space? His brother will be in feature space, the synonyms of feature words. And so if this word is appearing like this in feature space, will it also be very close to this one? Or what? That's the question we first. We estimate the transformation between the two by Rensec and find the common words. And after that, we start to study where they are. Okay, we will call a synonym as something which is taken from the same realistic place. And this may be homonyms in the sense that they functionally they are the same, but in reality they are from two different locations, and metonyms is the other way around. They are not similar looking, but they are from the same position. We want to have, ideally, synonyms which are close in feature space as well. There is no guarantee because the features have not been designed that way, but ideally your feature space would rule out any difference in perspective on the building or on the object in general. So ideally, with your ideal feature set, in two different pictures with a different viewpoint or a different type of illumination, they would be close.
So in this thing, you are saying that you have these circles were the feature point, or they are the word? The word can represent lots of feature points, is that right?
So here we have feature space,
yeah.
And here we have two images.
That's right.
Let's draw this. So here we have a house in reality. Here we have one image with the house. And here we have another image. This is a different in viewpoint,
yeah.
Can also be different in illumination.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. This is darker, this is lighter. Now we look for this point in reality, in this image being here and in this image being here. Mm-hmm. Now of course these two details look different. If they are stored in this huge feature space, then ideally this one would be covered if this is the word area. One of 4,000 different words in feature space, then this one and this one, they would be in the same word.
Okay.
In reality, that if you look at the two synonyms and you compare it for the buildings, then they are almost the same distributed as for random combinations. In other words, we now look at, so this I take as a reference. This is word number one. This is word number, I don't know. And then the distance between word number one and word number I don't know, it should be small, right? Because ideally, for ideal feature set, this should be small. In reality, if I take two random pairs, I get the red line of distribution. If I take them to be from two buildings, from which I know that should be the same, the almost the same distribution. In other words, so where does this come from? This comes from the fact that the SIFT vector, imagine that this is the original building. That if I compare this, and this is the, and this now looks like this. And this looks, so, almost identical. But if you look very carefully, then these dimensions of the SIFT vector are totally different from these dimensions of the SIFT vector. These dimensions are totally different. These dimensions are totally different. And these dimensions are totally different. In other words, for the majority, only the non-circled ones are the same. So a very small shift of the picture will cause five groups of 100. These are the dimensions 1 to 8. This is 9 to 16 and so on until you are at 128 here. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 out of 5 times. So 40 out of 128 dimensions are radically different in the two representations. Are you with me? So a epsilon shift in the original picture, which for human viewing looks very much the same, causes a dramatic effect in the SIFT representation. Because there are very many artificial lines. So that's why two synonyms, which should be mapped in an ideal feature space on top of each other, are almost as, can be very close, or can be very apart, you can't tell.
But is it due to the SIFT, or is it due to because you are going from SIFT to words?
No, it is due to SIFT.
But because SIFT, he showed lots of experiments that it is invariant to viewpoint and scale. And
yeah, if you precisely pinpoint it at exactly the same spot. Hmm. So, and this is what you don't do in reality, because there's no one to pinpoint it for you. You have to compute it.
So the detection is creating problems.
Yeah, and so that's why dense helps, because dense will always cover to the best of your ability the same thing. Yeah. But with dense, you insert, by definition, you insert noise, because all the points which don't matter are also included in the data.
Okay.
Yeah, but it's due to the fact that whenever I cross this border and to move it into another cell of SIFT, that's why it will cause a dramatic effect on the position in feature space. In this case, in this simple example, there are 40 out of 128 dimensions which are different. Are you? Yeah? So, presumably, this example would be, rather than being close to here, it's somewhere here. Yeah? And even you will find contributions exactly on the other side of the feature space. For example, if there is also illumination from one side, then half of the gradients is not seen anyway, because it's in the dark, after which it moves somewhere to somewhere completely different in feature space.
But in this one, these points you are comparing, you haven't solved the correspondence that this is exactly the same point?
That is, okay, that's fair enough, in the sense that this is solved by Rensac, in this case. But you can be pretty sure. Okay, so there is a point of debate, whether that is exactly the same spot.
Yeah, because so Rensac, I mean, you will, when you want to do the homography, you will assume the correspondence is known, is that right? Then you will find the homo, and Rensac will do which points you want to select to find
out. Yeah, but RANSEC will do much better job than selecting exactly the same spot than if you do a salient point detector. Mm. Because RANSEC will compare two images to the best of their ability. Mm. Salient point detector would only select the best one from general knowledge without looking at the second image.
So in RANSEC, you are solving the both the correspondence and also finding homography.
Yes. So what you could do, if that if you're searching for this building, you get now a much better response simply by throwing away 90% of the code books, because they are correlated anyway. That if it is not stored in this one, where is my pencil? That basically you say that if these are three words, well, this contains the house like this, and this contains the house more or less like this, and this contains the house like this. You don't see the difference. Doesn't matter, because you say this is a synonym and this is a synonym. I don't need them for my information content. I have just enough of this. And that's when you can remove 90% of the code. So you get a lot smaller code book. Effectively, this is much the same as you would do text analysis. You have a text which is a paragraph. If this paragraph contains five times the word, say, boat, and this paragraph contains five times the words ship, then you would say, well, they're on the same topic. Yeah? And if it and this text would contain three times the word boats and five times the word ship, I only need one of the two in order to decide that they're on the same topic.
This will work only if the synonyms are close in the feature space, right? If they're far apart in the feature space, then you're losing...
You just record that if they are far apart in the feature space, that's created by the measuring of the features, but you record the similarity.
At the same time, you will still assign it to the group clusters, but then you eventually...
Because I maintain it's a product of the artificiality of the features, not necessarily. Because it's the same features in this case as boat doesn't look like ship, the B doesn't look like the S and the O, yeah? So this is everything starting with the B, this is everything starting with the S. That's not the point. The point is that they are correlated. Okay, and here you have a reality of a word. That this is one synonym word, this is his brother synonym. So it could be somewhere completely different in feature space, but it will contain details of a building, and the same details may also be covered there, not by design, but by the fact that it is slightly shifted, but this one, through the eyes of the shift factor, looks more like this one, then maybe, and this one looks like that one, because they're in the same word, they have close shift values, but this one doesn't look like that one. Are you with me? So it is important to understand, if you use shift, that these artificial boundaries in shift create large jumps in feature space, whereas there are epsilon differences in to our perception. That's important to understand. And does it matter that it is so wild? No, it doesn't. Because imagine that here there is, what after all, I want to count how many are here and how many are here and how many are here. If there is enough variation in the image, the fact that I have four counts here and six counts here and eight counts here, after all, we'll say this is about boats and ships, or this is about a specific type of building. The fact that it's also evidence for something completely different, like this, doesn't matter because they are not found here. Or maybe they're found here, but then I can no longer discriminate these types of things. No? Conclusion. Visual synonyms are not close at all in feature space. And there's a considerable redundancy in codebooks. And you have to live with it unless you come with a better feature, for which permanently an epsilon change in feature space in the real space only includes an epsilon change in feature space. but that in, and without intent. So closeness is, and that's where the trick is. The trick is that such a universal feature doesn't exist because it depends on what you want to do with the feature. And this is the source of many codebook reductions we are currently working on. Okay, let's consider this one, recently published. Another PhD student of mine. There is a kernel between two histograms. As I explained earlier, we put this in the SVM, and then you say that I want to define a new kernel which yields exactly the same product. How do I do that? I define a kernel and I start to remove things, the ones which are, but then I take care that the overall sum remains exactly the same. So I try to, I put to zero as many as I can, and I just increase the weights and decrease the weights of the new kernel until I have the smallest possible set. You do this by lasso on image pairs until I have exactly reconstructed the same kernel score with the least number of codebook elements. So, for instance, with the, and you see here the results, that if the aim is now to rule out as many codebook elements as I can, and only to survive the ones which are informative, that is to say, for which the total sum of non-zero elements is exactly the same as the kernel for the trial images. Now, of course, you need, if you go too low, as in the purple one, you have too much variation, but if you do a reasonable amount, you'll see here the result. That, if I started with 4,000, I believe it were 4,000 codebook elements, then I get the same, but if I reduce it to 1,200, there's a minor decrease in performance. By the time I get to 400, so that's 1/10 of the original codebook, I still have an acceptable performance. So convex reduced books, codebooks, are equally accurate and 10 times faster because their size is 10 times smaller. This applies also to feature vectors, it applies to nonlinear, it applies to everything. And if you want, and the big advantage is that if you want still to apply the same codebook size, you can now compute it. For feature vectors, you can't. It simply takes too much time. So effectively, by taking a smaller codebook, we've now achieved a 4% accuracy gain by applying this.
So the gain because of the, so one is when you reduce them it's faster, right?
No, it's either faster, yeah, or more memory. We have another scheme submitted to ICCV, mm-hmm, for which we can, in the same amount of memory, we can cope 100 times bigger codebooks, and the bigger the codebook if you have the data is always better. So there, the result will be that it is 5 times more accurate in the same amount of time and the same amount of memory than in this scheme.
So the main point is that you are reducing, that you are maintaining the better words as compared to...
The combined set of all the words,
yeah,
covers the same amount of information as the highly redundant original set. Hmm. And here you pick it out by convex reduction, the standard convex reduction scheme, which you take care that the kernel sum is identical for randomly selected images. Mm-hmm. There are other ways to do that. Yeah?
It's better 10 minutes.
Oh!
So maybe I'll stop asking questions.
Yeah. This is also very important. We want to reintroduce. What makes a boat a boat? I will discuss it also in the public lecture. But if you look at the Among Us in computer vision, what is so striking that you can detect the boat. Because the variety, the appearance variety to the general public is even moderate, but to us it's incredible. Because a boat can look like this, and a boat can look like that, and a boat can look like that. And so what is the constant factor? That is all, we are in the business of finding the constant factor. We are in the business of finding the invariance. If the feature doesn't tell us which is invariant, we have to learn it, but basically we say it invariably, after you take these calculations, gets to this point in space, after which it is invariant again. We are in the business of finding invariant. And so the question is, what is the object in the middle? Now, you have to answer, otherwise I won't progress, but quick, please. Very good. And how do you know? Yeah, but you haven't even seen the object. Well, I smuggled a bit, but it could have been a floating refrigerator, not in the Netherlands, but in other countries. But we call it a boat for the moment. Because the context is much more invariant in this case than the object itself. And effectively, the hole in the water defines very good a boat or a rock. And the fact that the transition is from the water typical pattern, where, by the way, water is not blue, only in Florida and in holiday pictures, the water is blue, otherwise water is gray, but has this very typical pattern. If you look for invariance, that is what you want to look for. And the transition of this texture pattern into very straight things, that is typically your boat. I will show you the evidence in the image in a moment. Okay, so no segmentation. You haven't seen the object itself. You only have seen, so the context is ultimately important. So let's look for the evidence. Well, we do this in the following way. We sum per contribution of to the classification weight, and then we map it back unto the feature. Where the evidence is positive, it will be yellow. Where the evidence is negative, it will be blue. Now let's plot that for a few things. Here you see that, oh, I shouldn't walk too much. Here you see that these details are highly yellow. And what is this? This is this when it is under 45 degrees and black on the one side and not so black on the other side. That's apparently, amidst the whole data set, that's apparently highly selective for motorcycles. If you think about it, this exactly discriminates a motorcycle, this detail, from a car, because in a car it will not so be so obvious. Other things is spread evidence, maybe here also is strong evidence, but it's collected around the wheels. The variation here can be such that it can be happening in many things, but this one is specifically for motorcycles. If you are not convinced, let's consider this one. The boat, there's an enormous yellow mass around here, especially when you sum it. And there is yellow mass around here. Now look very carefully. This by itself can be anything, so that's why it's dark blue. As soon as this comes above a certain, in a certain shape, it starts to be very yellow.
So yellow is different.
You promised.
Yellow is what?
Yellow is positive. Yep. And blue here is even more clear. This can only be belonging to a boat, namely a sailboat, because it's this versus the texture of the sky. If this detail could also be something on the land, like the end of a building or something. But as soon as it starts the sky, it's positive. This portion of yellow can easily be a motor bicycle, so that's why it's negative. But you see that the yellow and the summed yellow is where the positive evidence is. So the positive evidence for a boat, in this case, is in the water, added with a few details. Parked cars, very similar. Okay. So we've demonstrated that there is the Whereas in the word counting and the histogram formation, you throw away all the location of the image. Everything. You make soup out of it. You take the patches, you order them randomly again in the image, the result will be identical. So we have to reintroduce locality in order to gain something. That was the purpose of this. And up to 2009, we tried to get rid of as many the local order at all. We only looked for patches, but we didn't care about the order of the patches. So that's where this comes in. Where is the evidence? My student, other student, took the following example, that if you know the location, ideal location, this is a theoretical study, you know the ideal location of say, and you plot the recognition scores, then you'll see that the context of the bottle and the boat does it better than the actual object itself. For all other things, the object itself does it better. Are you with me? So for boats, you more need the sea than the boat itself to recognize it. And for the bottle, which has also no fixed appearance by itself, it's the same. Well, I'll do that in a minute. For bike, car, dog, table, the context is irrelevant. You can cut it out, put it in any other picture. Why? Because the dog is everywhere in the world. So context is not informative. When the ideal localization is known, however, a priori, then the context doesn't matter. If you know where the glass is, you can always classify it as a glass. So this is a theoretical study. And here is the main conclusion. The ideal localization always improves accuracy. For cow, this is considerable, but for plants, this is enormous improvement. This enormous, so if I can ideally localize the plant, and then, without knowing that it is a plant, but I can ideally localize it, then I have a potential huge gain. Let's formulate it again. So this is ideal localizations. These are then highest ranked, this is lowest ranked, and this is, they are things which are dominated by the context. The fact that this is all blue, it tells you that this must be an airplane. And this is the worst ones. This is a bird, well, very much looks like an airplane. So this goes to prove that the importance and not so importance for some objects, which can go everywhere, context is not so important. And even a detail can be very important. Okay, so context usually plays a role, but at other cases, depending on the type of object, the details can be gaining by itself. What people have done was to cut the original image into blocks and then compute for each of them, compute the bag of words as I explained. And if you find this on top and this in the bottom, this type of, then of course this air will never be at the bottom. So if it is blue and in the top portion of the image, then this will be an outside, very indicative for an outside scene. This one will be in the bottom, when found in the bottom, will be indicative for a landscape. And we're going to use it as follows. We're going to generate boxes, as many as we can. Let's call that exhaustive search. So these are a few examples, large, small, and we're going to treat them each individually and see whether we accidentally hit upon the object. And these people have done it in 2004, very fast algorithms, Felsenswalb, very good algorithm, nevertheless enormous amount, so that it takes by far too long to compute. What have we done? We realized that you need to find, at least need to find the box which is accidentally hitting on the object. So we want to have a low number of images which are highly accurate delineation. That's what we need. And the paper was appearing in CVPR and a few other places. And it has to be hierarchical, because an image may repeat itself arbitrarily. So did we do? We looked at an arbitrary image of a cow, this one, and we grouped all pixels together which were similar in one way or another. In this case, same color. In this case, same texture. In this case, same, don't know, shading, doesn't matter. And we would form hierarchies of things which were grouped together on a similar basis. And then we would have an order like this, that if this is the original image with all sorts of divisions, then they would, one way or another, group to this by relaxing one of the congruent features, and eventually it would end up in the whole picture. And then we would select the most useful boxes. So typically a set of maybe 400, 100 boxes from each image, after which you compute in the same manner as before the words, the word counts, the histograms of each of these boxes. And this would lead to the automatic selection after a few processing steps, or this is the of single isolated sheep, or even groups of sheep. We can't decide because it's intrinsically hierarchical. This is competitive papers, but even in this circumstance you can see that we can select isolated animals for real. And in this case we are able to find a selection of a woman. To the right is our solution. And you see that it is much more tranquil selection of objects. What we want to achieve, that if we have an average overlap with the original idea of 88%, and this is typically how that looks like. As you can see, this is a very good overlap with the original bike. This is a very good overlap with the original bull, and this is a very good overlap with a single person. So an average best overlap of 88% is a really very efficient way to get the localization of an unknown image. And how can you use it for classification? Well, you have a ground truth. Now you need also a ground truth in the image, no longer only a label, but also where it is. Then you form these grouped patches. You form a hierarchy. You put them into a training set. You select the most obvious one. You train it with a standard pipeline. And then you put in the others to see simply which one are best until you have found the patches which are best classifying. And then an arbitrary image is put in the same, and you look, you treat each of these patches as the original image. As a consequence, in the Pascal VOC classifier for things like plane, bikes, birds, we made a jump from this is our, we did it worse for bikes, but on average we won 9 out of 20 classes, and sometimes improving it considerably, and sometimes removing it, losing it. But on average, it was much more than the others. So we need to reintroduce location, which was totally lost by counting only words in histograms. And the best way to do that is bottom up. You group the data as the image tells you how to do that. And it describes the object roughly, and that is exactly what is needed, because at the border of the object is where the information is. A large variety of features to group helps, not only focus on color, not only focus on intensities, not only focus on, but do it everywhere. And the object classification goes up. And this helps to find in double concepts. You have to realize that if you optimize it for on the basis of histograms without location, those images will come out on top, which is a beauty contest. The whole image points at, because every patch in the image is weighted equally. So images which are totally dominated by, say, a horse and with the grass and the sky and the tree, very, and then the horse with the, that will come out as the horse image. If another, say, you want to have a horse with a car or a horse with a spoon, the spoon is totally squeezed out because the spoon would typically have a context of tiles and washing bins and so on. So the fact that it is non-localized means that the second concept is totally squeezed out of it. So that's why if you do it localized, then the remaining of the image, which is no longer effective, could be dedicated to spoons or to cars. And that's what happened here, you can see it. For instance, that car plus dog is an enormous improvement when you compare it on the non-localized version. And car plus horse is an enormous improvement over the non-localized version. If you say this one, a bottle and a chair, they don't win each other because usually they come together closely. So that's, so the optimal choices for a non-localized version is almost identical to with the localized version. But if they are very far apart, the two concepts, you gain a lot if you use the localized version. On average, you go from here to here, almost a double in performance for this. If Mubarak, the hour is there, this would be a natural place to stop. Okay. If there is much more to tell.